Good morning and welcome to Faith Fellowship Church. I am Jits and I serve at Marikina 2 Community. It is wonderful to have you gather with us today, for we know that you will be blessed and encouraged in the presence of the Lord. Kindly message below where you are joining from, especially if this is your first time, so we can connect with you. We care about you and we want to help you in any way we can. If you want somebody to pray for you or with you, kindly message us on the number on screen. Or perhaps you are going through a very difficult time. Well, our counseling team will be there to help you and we will be honored to journey with you. Or you can visit our website at ffaurora.org to find more about us and ways to get connected. Let's lift our hearts and worship to the Lord. May His word be a blessing to all of us. This will be shared to us by our senior pastor, Pastor Eniong Hilario. Be sure to check our discussion guide on our FB page so you can dig deeper into God's word yourself, with your family, or with your faith group. Now, let's sing to the Lord.
morning. We're so glad that you've joined us today for worship. We trust that you'll be blessed as you've come together with us this morning. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we come into your most holy presence this day. We give you thanks that you are our God. Thank you, Lord, that you love us so much. And we pray as we worship you in spirit and in truth, that you would be exalted in our praises. You would be exalted in our worship, in our hearts, in our homes, and in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So no matter where you are, if you're here in the Philippines or maybe somewhere else in the world, thank you for joining us. Let's worship our God, for he is worthy, amen. Philippians 2, verses 5 through 11 says this: Have the mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
The whole
the body of Christ, that as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, the enemy is underneath our feet. We stand on the authority of the Lord Jesus. Our hope is in heaven. Hallelujah and amen.
Jesus in the street. Desire there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Lord, we just speak the name of Jesus over our families today. We speak the name of Jesus over our sons and daughters, over our marriages. We speak the name of Jesus over our communities, over this government. We speak the name of Jesus. We speak the name of Jesus over this nation. And Lord Jesus, we speak your name over COVID-19. You are higher and bigger than it all, God. And it will bow its knee to you, Jesus. As we bow our knees and our hearts to you this day, we speak the name of Jesus, who is above all and in all and through all. We love you, Jesus. We praise you this morning. May your word speak into our hearts and change our lives this day as we live for you and worship you. And God's people said, amen and amen.
Imagine yourself being wrongfully accused of a crime that you did not commit, and then being wrongfully condemned to suffer in prison for it. And then after being in prison for, let's say, 36 long years, you will finally be set free. Sounds incredible, like some stuff that you only see in the movies, but that really happened to three young men named Alfred, Ransom, and Andrew. In 1983, they were charged with a murder and were convicted to life imprisonment. Alfred, Ransom, and Andrew were just barely 16 years old at that time. But then in 2019, 36 years later, a retrial of their case was done. And these three men, now at 52 years of age, were found to be not guilty. It was a case of wrongful conviction for a crime that they did not commit. These men were wrongfully tried, convicted, and condemned for a crime that they did not commit. For 36 long years, they suffered the penalty of wrongful condemnation. Praise God, however, that even though belatedly 36 years late, in fact, the wrongful sentencing was overturned, and these three men, Alfred, Ransom, and Andrew, they were finally set free. No longer are they standing condemned, a long wait in their quest for justice and freedom. It was interesting because at their release, one of the three men said, he looks forward to spending the rest of his life praising God and taking care of his family. He said, I've always been dreaming about this. This day, I've been dreaming about this, that man said. The second man said something that really struck me. In speaking about his release, this man said, I have got to learn how to live right now. I've got to learn how to live. Because all of those 36 years, life was not life while they were in prison. Life is life only when you are truly free. Isn't that true? But did you know that Jesus has come to set you free? Jesus came in order that the condemnation that was placed upon us will be lifted up so that we could learn to live right now. Jesus came to overturn a death sentence that was placed upon all men, a sentence of which all of us are actually truly guilty, whether you recognize it or not. And we are still on the topic of Jesus' effect. And today, I have some really good stuff to share. It is this. It is about one of the most important effects of Jesus on us, and it is this. There's no longer any condemnation in Him. No longer condemned, the Jesus effect. In Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 2, it says there, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Now, the word condemned comes from the word katakrima, which means a sentence or an adverse verdict. To be condemned means to be sentenced to a particular punishment. The three men that I mentioned a while ago, Alfred, Ransom, and Andrew, they were condemned to life imprisonment. We, however, we are condemned to death sentence because of sin, as Romans chapter 6, verse 23 declares, "For the wages of sin is death." So when it comes to sin, we are all guilty. When it comes to sin, we are not being wrongfully judged. Yes, we have all done it. We are guilty as charged. But this is what is awesome about all this. Despite the undeniable proof that we are all guilty of sin, those who turn to Jesus Christ and those who turn and place their faith unto Him, Jesus would take away and would overturn what would otherwise be a rightful condemnation. Jesus took away the sentencing, even if such were actually deserved. However, when we disregard Jesus and when we refuse what He has come to offer, the condemnation remains. Yes, without Jesus, we are condemned. Firstly, the condemnation manifests itself in a spiritual prison that we are unable to set ourselves free from. It is pretty much like a person sentenced for a crime. He shall go to jail and he would spend time in prison as the penalty. A spiritual prison, however, locks up the person without Christ. And this is what this spiritual prison brought about sin looks like. This is what Paul has to say in Romans 7, 18 to 19. He says, "For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh, for I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good that I want, but the evil that I do not want is what I keep on doing." The person without Christ is condemned in this spiritual prison. That is his sinful nature. The good that he wants to do, he could not. But the bad that he does not want to do, he does because of his sinful nature. There is therefore no hope for that person apart from Jesus Christ. And no matter what that person does, he becomes captive to that power of sin dwelling within his heart. And no amount of self-help, no amount of motivation, no amount of good works can set him free from this. We cannot do anything to set ourselves free from being a captive to a heart of sin. No escaping. Truly condemned, as would a convicted criminal would be. No way out of the sentence of being locked up in a prison of sin. And about this, we are all found to be guilty. But there is an answer, and the answer is Jesus Christ. I love what the beloved John says in John chapter 3, verses 16 to 19. And I particularly like how Eugene Peterson in the Message version says, it reads there, "This is how much God loved the world. He gave His Son, His one and only Son. And this is why, so that no one need be destroyed, by believing in Him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God did not go to all the trouble of sending His Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. He came to help, to put the world right again. Anyone who trusts in Him is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust in Him has long since been under the death sentence without knowing it. And why? Because of that person's failure to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God who, when introduced to him. So Jesus Christ, when we place our faith in Him, when we trust in Him, we will be acquitted, and therefore we are no longer condemned. Jesus, by dying on the cross, did it. He took away the verdict and the condemnation that we were all supposed to receive. Jesus came to set man free from the condemnation that was brought about by our sin. It's not that we are not guilty or that we are being wrongfully charged. No, we are all guilty of sin. What Jesus Christ came to do is to acquit us despite the fact that we are guilty. And it is in believing in Jesus Christ that we are acquitted, and therefore we are freed from the sentence or the condemnation that stood against us. This is very important for all of us to grasp. You see, this has a very close parallel to a person spending time in prison for a crime that he has committed. Isn't it so true that in order for that prisoner to experience having a life of freedom outside, he either has to complete or finish the sentence, or in some way be pardoned for it, or his case retried and overturned? The judgment and the condemnation has therefore to be cleared first, and then and only then can he live his life in freedom. And this is what Jesus exactly did when it comes to the sin of every man. The judgment, the sentence, the verdict, the condemnation that was upon man because of his sin was overturned by Jesus Christ and what he has done. We are all guilty, but because of Jesus, we were all acquitted. And this had to be fulfilled first. And we have to place our faith in Christ in order to be justified. And what did Jesus Christ do again? Through the cross. At the cross where Christ was crucified, He took upon Himself all the sin that man has committed. And that is why there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No longer condemned from what? This means three things. One, we are no longer condemned from judgment. But by judgment, I mean the penalty, I mean the sentence, I mean the verdict, I mean the condemnation that was intended for us all. Jesus took them all at the cross, and sin's penalty and sentence, which was spiritual death, is no longer upon those who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ. Two, we are no longer condemned from the accusations against us. Jesus Christ acquitted us. By faith in Him, we are justified, and therefore we are no longer guilty. We are therefore not to permit ourselves to live in guilt. If Christ has freed us from the sentence itself, He has also come to free us from the guilt that it brings. Sometimes this is the problem. We allow ourselves to suffer from the accusations that we or others bring to ourselves. And this happens when we simply just cannot forgive ourselves. Living under the weight of guilt and accusation. We keep carrying the weight of guilt, and we live in shame. And some of us feel that this guilt can be appeased by actually living in pain or by punishing ourselves. Or often, you would hear these statements that are very defeatist in nature. What do I mean? I notice that the people who live under the weight of guilt often say to themselves, I can't do it. I don't deserve this, or I cannot change. When we say these things, we are in effect reinforcing and bringing condemnation to ourselves. But we must also not allow ourselves, allow others, I mean, to bring us condemnation where Christ has already forgiven us. In Christ, there is now no condemnation, so we must not allow ourselves and others to condemn us. This is so true. When others cannot simply let go of our failures. You know, when other people respond, because when we fail, they not only respond by being hysterical, but sometimes they respond by being historical. Sometimes this happens in the family, between spouses, or between parents and children. Whereas Jesus said, there is now no condemnation, we, however, love to bring back failures and sins and point it to each other's faces. When this happens to us, we have to cling unto the truthfulness of Jesus' words. We are no longer condemned. And yet there is also a spiritual, invisible enemy that loves to condemn. Satan. Satan is the accuser who makes us doubt the love, the grace, and the forgiveness of our God. And so when Satan does condemn you, do come to Jesus and remind yourself of this truth. In Him, you are no longer condemned. When Satan accuses you of your forgiven sins, tell yourself and tell Satan or his demons that you are forgiven and you are no longer condemned in Jesus Christ. As Isaiah 54 verse 17 declares, no weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed, and you shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. And this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord. Thirdly, we are no longer condemned also from broken relationships. And this is firstly and primarily with God first. Sin breaks the relationship, and the condemnation that sin brings creates a wedge in our relationship with God. And the more condemned that we feel, the more distant God seems. You know, instinct tells us that when we have hurt or offended someone, or vice versa, what do? We flee, or we hide, or we avoid the person concerned. Jesus, however, did more than just to forgive and set us free from condemnation. With the forgiveness and the guilt that our sin brings now done away with, Jesus also restored our relationship with God. As Romans chapter 5 verse 1 declares, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we now have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This means, now that with the broken relationship restored, we can draw near to Him. Guilt and shame no longer must prevent us from coming to God. Instead, by the justification that Jesus has brought, it has given us that peace with God. So do not let the feeling of guilt and condemnation keep you from coming to God. Romans chapter 8 verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Jesus' effect on us is this: we are no longer condemned. The judgment, the verdict, and the spiritual death sentence that came with sin is no longer upon us because of Jesus Christ and what He has done. He was crucified on the cross to pay the penalty of our sins. Jesus Himself made it possible for the condemnation to be done away with. Believe it. This will happen to those who place their faith in Jesus Christ. Will you do it? Do you want to do it? Will you make that declaration of faith in Christ? If this is you, I would like for you to type on the chat box, "Today I place my faith in Jesus." Will you do that, please? I'd like to address believers, Christians, followers of Jesus Christ who actually may be feeling condemned right now. Do you still find yourself condemned? And that is sentenced to a prison of being in captivity to sin. You cannot seem to do what is good. And the bad that you are avoiding, you cannot help but do. You're in prison. You're in a state of condemnation. Set yourself free by recommitting your life to Christ. Are you bound by guilt in your heart? Set yourself free from the accusing thoughts by renewing your trust in Christ, who no longer condemns, but loves and welcomes and is gracious to you. Believe this truth from God. And if you are this Christian, can you type on the chat box, "Today, I renew my faith in Christ." No longer condemned. That is what we are in Jesus Christ. God bless you. Have a peaceful week ahead.
Thank you for joining us today, and we trust that you've been blessed and encouraged. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the works of the Lord, especially during this challenging time. Please continue to support our church and all of its ministries and projects. You can visit our website and FB page for more details in giving. We are excited because we are into a new season of ministry here at FFA. Kindly check out our weekly online ministry through our FB page. We're glad to announce that FFA prayer room is still ongoing every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Kindly comment "prayer room" down below and our team will get in touch with you. Let's unite our hearts into prayer before our King. This coming Saturday, we want to see you at the place. This is our monthly worship, prayer, and fellowship. This is always a special time, and we know you don't want to miss that. Calling all kids age 4 to 13, we love to see you on Faith Kids Online each week after the Sunday service. The team is having so much fun, and we love to see you there too. Kindly comment "Faith Kids" down below and our team will get in touch with you. Deadline of registration is every Friday each week.
Well, Christmas is coming soon. December is just around the corner. I have a special announcement to all of you. Starting next Sunday, the very first Sunday of December, we are having a change in our schedule of our online worship service. The Tagalog service will be at 8 in the morning and our English service will be at 10. Please do take note of that. Our Tagalog service will be at 8 in the morning and our English service will be at 10. And our theme for the month of December is "Christmas is Good News." We would like for you to bring the gospel home. We would like for you to let members of your family know about the good news that is all about Jesus Christ. So please do take note of our activities this December. Go to our Facebook page and do check our website, ffaurora.org, for you to know more about this. God bless you. See you next Sunday.
Let me pray for you as we close this time of worship. In Numbers chapter 6, 22 to 26 says, May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you His favor and give you His peace. Let us pray. We praise you, our Heavenly Father, our great and awesome God, the God who seated on the throne of heaven, and all the powers and dominions belongs only to you. Thank you, Lord, for in spite of the troubles and the hardship that we have experienced, we can still rise up and be confident of the coming days. For you have said in Psalms 46 verse 10, "Be still and know that I am God." Yes, Lord, we will be still and we will be standing tall in the midst of uncertainties. For we believe that the God who saved us will be the same God who will journey with us now and forever. And all the praises and the adoration belongs only to you, our one and only God. This we pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen.